So far, we've seen all the barriers to prevent sperm from one species making it to the egg of a different species. But there are further mechanisms to continue reproductive isolation after fertilization takes place. So this is post-zygotic isolation. So we had all of our mechanisms of pre-zygotic isolation that prevented mating from happening in the first place, or in the case of the pollen tubes, the pollen actually making it to the egg itself. And then we have now fertilization takes place. The wrong sperm has made it to the wrong egg, okay? But we then have what's called post-zygotic isolation. And there's three things here that can happen. First is that conception occurs, but the hybrid offspring will not live. Secondly is that the hybrid may live, but be infertile. Third is that something may not happen until the next generation along. I'll go through these in turn. So first, with hybrid inviability, we have wood frogs and leopard frogs, and if you get them to mate with each other, sperm from one, eggs from the other, they have hybrid offspring, but the fertilized egg goes through the first mitosis, second mitosis, 8-16 cell phase, and then just stops. The genetics is all wrong, and so growth stops after just a few cell divisions. Okay, here's a horse. We have a female horse, and he's really not that attractive, but it does happen, and it can be done, you know, on various farms, that you get a female horse and cross her with a male donkey, and you get a mule, okay? That's how you get mules. Mules are perfectly wonderful domestic animals. They are great work animals. They'll haul, they're strong, they're even pretty smart, but they're sterile. So they can grow up, live a fairly long life, but they're sterile. Now, what's going wrong? How do we get hybrid infertility? Let's take this cartoon as just a simplification of what's going on between a horse and a donkey. So here we have the horse that has three pairs of chromosomes, okay? And it undergoes meiosis, and you get the haploid eggs produced by the mother horse, okay? And then you have the donkey dad. He has two pairs of chromosomes, okay? Humans have 23 pairs. This example just has two, okay? So then they undergo meiosis, okay? So then fertilization takes place. So we have two chromosomes from dad, three from mom, okay? But then when this individual grows up, meiosis fails, because meiosis will only proceed if you've got the sister chromatids, they find a homologous partner, they create a tetrad, okay? So you could conceivably have two tetrads here at the beginning of meiosis, the long chromosome and this medium chromosome, okay? But this one doesn't have a partner. So meiosis fails in hybrid because one or more chromosomes have no homolog with which to line up in that critical first stage of meiosis. So that's done. So in the case of the mule, okay, the horse, in fact, has 64 chromosomes, okay, so it's 32 chromosome pairs. The donkey has 62 chromosomes, or 31 chromosome pairs, okay? So this is, in fact, the most compatible hybrid you could have amongst any two of the living equids, or horses, because they're only off by one. If you tried to cross a Burchell zebra with a horse, you'd have a lot of unpartnered chromosomes, okay? And with any of these others, it just wouldn't work, okay? Now, a lot of people have wondered, you know, what could happen if you're trying to hybridize humans with some of our nearest relatives, different kinds of apes, okay? And so it wouldn't work. As far as we know, nobody's ever actually done the experiment. But if you did, it wouldn't work because we have the 23 pairs of chromosomes, we have 46 chromosomes, and all the other apes have one more pair of chromosomes. So they'd have that, there would be that one unpartnered chromosome that would fail at meiosis. Okay, the third way that things can go wrong with hybrids is what's called F2 hybrid breakdown, okay? Our F1, the mule is an F1, okay? That F1 was infertile, it was sterile because of the problems with meiosis. But in other species, you can cross things and you get the F1 that's fertile and viable, so it grows up. So you can do this with these copepods. It's a kind of crustacean. You can get it in maize or corn, green beans. These can be done. But then it's the next generation. You cross the F1 with another F1, and the F2 doesn't work. So we have the parental of species A crossed with the parental of species B. You have the F1, and that's fine. But then you cross the F1 with another, and then it all falls apart. Either this individual or this generation, they're infertile or they're inviable. So that's the end of that.